admit that person. Good evening, Zimbabwe. Good evening to all our viewers of Heart and Soul TV and radio. This evening, we are privileged to be joined by the former Minister of Information in Zimbabwe, Professor Jonathan Moyo, also a former Minister of Higher and Tertiary Education. He is a politician of note and an academic who has been an imposing figure on the political landscape of Zimbabwe. Now, the reason why we are joined by Professor Jonathan Moyo this evening is that we are going to be discussing mass media, public media, and its role in development of nations the world over. In particular, we are going to have a focus on Zimbabwe, looking at the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. Welcome, Professor Jonathan Moyo, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to join you.
Professor, let's just go straight into this. You are an academic and obviously have been in this media business for a very long time. Now, just open with explaining to us the role of public media in developing a nation, in particular Zimbabwe, the role that public media is playing in Zimbabwe, should play and is playing.
Well, I think, Blessing, perhaps we should start by problematizing what we mean by public media so that we unpack it and make it meaningful to something that we can all relate. Because I think there are quite some serious misconceptions about what public media is or are. As far as I'm concerned, all media is public. The distinction between public and private media is a false distinction. What I think might qualify as private media, for example, would be a telephone service, maybe some WhatsApp group, although increasingly many such groups are also becoming fairly public. I think, based on our experience in Zimbabwe and perhaps in the broader region, we have developed this concept or notion. It's more of a notion rather than a concept of public media to mean the media that are controlled, owned, or governed by the government of the day, or government-controlled media. I think that conceptually and legally, the distinction ought to be between state media, form of control of the media that we hold, and public media, private, simply because it is owned by someone or privately owned. It's not the ownership that defines where.
Okay, something's happening to your microphone. It's on mute now. Your microphone is on mute, so it's going off. Yeah, so you can go ahead.
Is that all right now? Yeah, yes, sorry. So I was saying that I think our discussion will be better focused if we distinguish only between state media and public media or all media. ZBC is not public media. The public has no role in how the ZBC is run. It's not part of the board. It doesn't participate, but it is owned by the state. Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust is not a state entity. It is a private entity. And its ownership and participation at Zimpapers does not make Zim Papers a public, a public media in the sense of what I think you were conveying. It would in fact make it a private media because Zim Papers is not owned by the state. Zim Papers is not a state media, although of course the experience we've had in Zimbabwe is that it has been state run more broadly, but specifically it has been government run and government control. So we do have this problem in our part of the world that our notions of public and private media are not well developed. I mean, I would be surprised if, for example, somebody said CNN is a private media. I mean, you cannot get a more public media than CNN, for example. So we do have these ownership issues that we need to refine. But yes, if we were to focus on Zimbabwe, our experience is that for the better part of our independence, the last 40 years, the media in our country has been state-dominated, but more specifically, government-dominated and government-run until the latter years when we saw the emergence what in our country is referred to as the private media. But the role of the media in general is crucial in the development of a society, and not just in the development of a society, but in its transformation. It is the only platform by which individuals and groups in the public arena interact, express themselves. The whole concept of freedom of expression, which is fundamental to the development of any society, is meaningless outside the role of the media.
Now, in light of the explanation that you have given, I want us to focus on what we would then call the state media, which is basically, as you've said, been controlled by government and funded by taxpayers' money, giving the public some certain expectation from it. What is it that the people of Zimbabwe should genuinely expect from ZBC, for instance, and Zim Papers?
Well, I made a distinction which I hope will inform our discussion as we proceed to distinguish between Zim Papers and ZBC. Zim Papers, by law, is not a state media. The state has never put a cent in Zim Papers. Remember, Zim Papers, and we are supposed to discuss this, I suppose, in greater detail as we move on. But Zim Papers is owned, 51% of it is owned by the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, and 49% by an array of private entities, including individuals. But it is really important, Blessing, that we not conflict ZBC with Zim Papers, because part, if not most, of what has gone wrong with the Zim Papers is this impression which over the years has been created, certainly by the government of the day, by the ZANU-PF government, that it is a state entity. It is not a state entity. But ZBC is a state entity, and that model of ownership, that somehow the state controls the media, runs the media, is itself a wrong model. It is very difficult to imagine a viable arrangement under which a state-owned media can discharge a constitutional role or obligation to the satisfaction of any community. It is very difficult to imagine that kind of a scenario. That is why in most democratic or constitutional I was going to say democratic countries, but in most constitutional democracies, you are not going to find the government owning, or rather the state, let us say, owning the media. You know about the Voice of America, for example. The Voice of America is state-owned and state-run, therefore. But the Voice of America cannot, by law, broadcast to the American people in the United States. Because by definition, what a state broadcasts is propaganda, by definition. It is impossible to imagine the state broadcasting anything else which is not propaganda, by definition. So the Americans have no problem with their Voice of America broadcasting propaganda to other nations. But they have a fundamental problem with the Voice of America broadcasting propaganda to the Americans. So in Zimbabwe, the fact that ZBC is a state-owned, and as you indicated, is partly funded, in fact, entirely, but partly in the sense that it does also advertise and generate revenues from those activities. But by and large, it's supposed to be funded from the licenses. It is that dispensation to collect license fees, but also from time to time, it can get allocations from Parliament. That fact makes it a propaganda institution. And if we were to have an honest discussion about it, then we would say its programming is dictated by the policy and ideological agenda of the government of the day.
Yes, in your submission, Professor, you talk of the conflation of Zim papers being mistaken as a state institution, rather state media. That is where the problem is, isn't it? Because it is supposed to be owned by private players like the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. What happened to the Mass Media Trust, which is supposed to be controlling that stake?
I think that the story of Zim papers in particular, in general, the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, is a very sad story, but it's also an instructive one if we are to understand what has happened in our country over the last 40 years in terms of the public platforms of communication. As many people who follow this matter would be aware, Zim Papers was owned by the Argus Group and other private entities in South Africa at independence. And Zim Papers used to be at least one of the major instruments, propaganda instruments of the Rhodesian state, along with the Inter-Africa News Agency, IANA. These two dominated the media scene in Zimbabwe at independence. It was difficult to imagine how the new state and the government in Zimbabwe in 1980 would function without some control, but access to these two, IANA and Zim Papers, that ran the Herald, Chronicle, and these titles that we all know. So fortunately for us as Zimbabweans, the Nigerian government, which at the time was very progressive and very actively involved in the liberation struggle for the countries in Southern Africa, donated $5 million United States dollars. not to the government of Zimbabwe and not to the state of Zimbabwe, but to the people of Zimbabwe.
How do you separate and it? How do you separate the state and the people?
You mean that is difficult to do? It's news to me to hear. In terms of how countries, communities, nations are configured, the basic understanding is that you have the state and society. A nation, a modern nation, is made up of the state and society. These are not the same things. The state is a legal construction, and it has certain rights, including the monopoly in the use of violence and control of the instruments of violence. It can set up an army, police, these sort of things. And the society are the people in their generality who are found within a nation state. The people in their generality. We, the people. And this is a very important issue for us because for the most part of our independence period, in fact, from 1980 to 2013, the notion of Zimbabweans as the people, the ordinary people, and therefore a constitutional constituent of what makes our nation never came into play. It only came into play with the 2013 constitution. But in 1980, it was obvious that it's the people who fought for their independence. It's the people who were behind the liberation struggle. It's the people who were responsible for the creation of the nation that became Zimbabwe on the 18th of April, 1980. And in recognition, the government of Nigeria, which, as I said, it became part of the liberation struggle, supporting the liberation struggle, in recognition of this fact that the people had liberated themselves and that the people will need the means of expression to articulate their values and so forth in the new society, and that they need these instruments, the government of Nigeria, donated $5 million. And the money was supposed to buy out the South African interests that controlled Zim Papers, that controlled the Inter-African News Agency, which became ZIANA. And that required a unique structure. And the best structure, it was not a parastatal to buy these interests, to buy the South African interests out. It was not a public company to buy these. It was not a ministry, not a ministry of information, but a trust. And not a private trust, not a family trust, but a public trust. And that trust was set up in terms of a deed of donation, and it's key, very important to underline that it was a deed of donation and trust, which then took control, at least with the majority control of 51%. And it's very important to recognize that there was a provision for the other entities, other private interests within the country. Now, when you set up a trust, let's say, what is critical about it to instruct our discussion is the question of the beneficiaries of the trust. Who are the beneficiaries of the trust? And that is indicated in the deed of donation and trust, who the beneficiaries are. Every trust is defined by its beneficiaries. A family trust says the children, the descendants, it makes clear who is intended to benefit. And this is a question that has not been raised. And if it has been raised, it has not been raised enough in the debate in Zimbabwe on the public media or its role. Because if you look at the deed of donation and trust that set up the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, it clearly says that the beneficiaries are the people of Zimbabwe. It does not say the government of Zimbabwe, and it would not have been difficult to say so. It does not say the state of Zimbabwe, and certainly does not say ZANU-PF. It says the people of Zimbabwe. Therefore, the people of Zimbabwe in their diversity, in their completeness, are the beneficiaries of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. And then it says the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust will acquire, and specifically it mentions the interests that were controlled by the Argus Group and other entities in South Africa in the acquisition of the Zimbabwe newspapers. And then it specifically says the owners of the Inter-Africa News Agency, which will change its name and become the Zimbabwe News Agency Ziana, as we used to know it. And then third, which was a critical arm of this, that it will also set up a Zimbabwe Institute of Mass Communication to train journalists. But critically, having defined the beneficiaries as the people of Zimbabwe in their diversity and generality, it also says what the objects are of this trust: to gather news, disseminate news within Zimbabwe, gather news from outside Zimbabwe, and disseminate to audiences outside Zimbabwe. But what for? For the media welfare of the people of Zimbabwe. And this concept is in the deed of donation and trust, that this is being done for the media welfare of the people of Zimbabwe. So if you have that as the backdrop, then you can look back and ask and evaluate whether Zim Papers in particular, but Zimbabwe media, Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust in general, has in fact discharged the responsibility arising from the objects that are set in the founding deed of donation and trust that was established in 1981, because the editorial policies, the structures are supposed to reflect the objects of the trust. And I would say to you, as far as Zim Papers is concerned, on the back of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust and my engagement or involvement with these structures, when I was appointed Minister of Information in 1980, I mean, I wish it was 1980, I was a student in 1980, in 2000, I was quite surprised, Blessing, when I was when I became a Minister of Information in 2000. My first cabinet meeting was, I think, the first week of August 2000. We were appointed toward the end of July of that year. The elections were in June, if you recall. So when you go to cabinet, the first meeting, you get the minutes of the last cabinet meeting. And usually the first order of business in cabinet is to confirm the minutes of the last meeting. Obviously, we're not in a position to confirm the minutes of the last meeting. We had not attended that meeting. The majority of the people who had been ministers then did not come back. You recall the composition of the 2000 cabinet. But what struck me with the minutes, because we got the record, was that the last meeting, among various things that it had done, had approved a list of companies, public entities, public enterprises, so-called, which were to be privatized, which were meant for privatization. There was a long list of companies that had been approved, for privatization. And there were many odd things about the list, striking things about the list. If Zimbabwe was a society where people are really interested in proper research, I would encourage such researchers, if they are there, to look for that list, because it tells a very interesting story. It looks like, 2000 was a dramatic year in all sorts of respect, but it looks like people sat around the table and imagined themselves asset stripping all over the place. And they were keen to get pieces of public assets that were owned by public enterprises or parastatals. To my shock, there were two companies, so to speak, that were on the list. One was Zimbabwe Newspapers, Zimpapers. The other was Kingston's. It was very surprising to find that Zimpapers and Kingston's are listed as public enterprises owned by the state to be offloaded by the state. For me, that was surprising. And I became seized with this issue. For me, it was like a baptism of fire. So I had to quickly find out, why did these two companies end up on such a list? Who put them? Did the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust approve? And if Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust had approved, because it is a private enterprise, publicly listed at the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange, why was this on the list with the enterprises owned by the state, parastatals and so forth? If Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust had decided through its board to offload part of its 51% ownership of Zimpapers, or all of it, this would have been a decision of the board of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, and it would have ended there in terms of the due diligence, and then the needful would follow. It would not come to cabinet. But that it was in cabinet was perplexing. To make a long story short, this is 2000. You will be aware that on the 14th of December in 2000, the board of Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust resolved to dissolve itself. Or at least came up with a resolution to dissolve itself. I was very active. I would say I was even instrumental in causing that to happen. And obviously, it was not my decision alone. We took the decision as a ministry and informed our principals accordingly. And I realized that there were various interests at play, but I had my own reasons too. And the most important reason why I caused the board of Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust to dissolve itself on the 14th of December 2000 was to stop the privatization of Zim Papers and Kingston's. For me, it was the best way of doing that. And because I just found it shocking that the guys who had been in government, the previous one, the one that we succeeded in 2000, had basically found some formula of grabbing state assets and parceling them out among themselves and so forth. And we had to stop that. And for me, that was the reason why I caused the dissolution, or at least the resolution. Because even though they took that resolution on the 14th of December 2000, and in fact ceased to operate as a board of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust thereafter, the trust itself was not dissolved legally. In other words, the steps that were now necessary to be done to dissolve the trust were not taken. Certainly, they were not taken by the time I was expelled from government in February 2005.
Why did you then continue to operate Zim Papers without the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust?
Well, and that is a very important question. For me, the question is, why then did you go from the 15th of December 2000 to the 18th of February 2005 without a trust? Well, of course, the technical answer, Blessing, is because I had dissolved it. Why would you want me to operate with something that is not there, or that I had caused to disappear? However, your question still stands, because, in fact, we intended to replace it with a public media trust, or something that we're going to call public media investment trust. But we did not get to do that because there were so many other things happening during that period which complicated the process, delayed the process. Also, you know, I have to be honest with you. This one thing I learned later, on the 16th of February 2005, is that when you are in government, and the late Vice President Mzenda used to say this to me a lot whenever I went to visit him, that if you have an idea to reform a policy or an institution in government, or to come up with a new law, do it quickly. Think about it, do it quickly, because you don't know what tomorrow will be like. But the reality of it is that that period where when you are, you know, we should have done something to replace the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, we were sitting pretty and comfortable, somehow believing that, you know, the common talk was to do something in any ministry, you need 2 terms. So the first term, you discover what's wrong, you learn and so forth, and then you consolidate the second term. So frankly, and in retrospect, foolishly, I thought I was going to deal with this problem of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust in my second term. You know, I didn't know that I had huge surprises waiting for me, that Cholocho would be declared reserved for women, and the Cholocho constituency, that is, and there will be all those things that happened. And after working so hard, I think, in that first term, the outcome was I was expelled before the elections, and I was not available to attend to that issue the second term. So I was sure that my successor was going to do that. I didn't do it because they were, you know, not only did we have IPA, as you recall, we also had the Broadcasting Services Act, and we had the Media and Information Commission. There were a number of issues that became a priority. However, I was surprised that four ministers after me, Jokonya, Mangwana, Paul Mangwana after Jokonya, Kanyiso Ndlovu after Paul Mangwana, and Shamu in the GNU, four ministers did nothing about this.
Up to now.
And until this year, a few months ago, that's when, there are interesting reasons why, that's when, with pressure coming up, especially from the portfolio committee in parliament, which was asking quite some fundamental questions about the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust and its control of Zim papers, the current minister resuscitated the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust by bringing back its last chairperson, Mr. Onam Kushi, who had dissolved himself. So he dissolved, is resolved and emerged, and is now back again as the chairperson of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. To make a long story short, why did they not do it? Well, I am dead serious that I did not do it because there were these other pressing issues, but also because I wrongly thought I would have a second chance. I was coming back for my second term as Minister of Information in 2005. But if, as for my colleagues, I discovered when I came back in 2013 why they did not do it. In fact, when I was reappointed Minister of Information in September of 2013, and went to the office, my first question was about the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. I wanted a copy of the deed of donation and trust. And I wanted the entire file. I wanted to find out what had happened since February 16, 2005, when I left the ministry. And I was shocked to find that after some 2 months, they asked to look for the file, to tell me that they could not find the file in the ministry, that the file for the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust was missing, could not be found. This then raised my curiosity and frustration. And I now wanted to find out what had happened. Like I was telling them, I want this yesterday. And when they realized I was very serious, they came back a week or so later and said the file had been retired at the National Archives. So it means somebody was so determined to just forget about the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust and get on with the new dispensation, as it were. And that, you know, when you send something to the National Archives, you are sending it into posterity. You are no longer going to be seized with it. You are no longer going to be dealing with it. So somebody, I never got to know who, because by the time I wanted to know, I was again kicked out of that ministry. I called Mr. Mkushi when I was told that this file was not there, to ask him if he had his own personal archives with the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust documents, and he said no. But worse, when the officers went to the to the National Archives, they could not find the file. And when something is said to have gone to the National Archives from a ministry for permanent recording there, and then you follow it to the National Archives and you don't find it, you don't need to be a rocket scientist to understand that some security organ would have taken the thing. So what I don't know, was it CIO, MID, PISI? I don't know.
You never found it.
The file, I think, is missing. Remember, I'm talking about the file. Mm-hmm. What has subsequently been found, but in its incomplete form, is the deed of trust. In fact, I have this. This is, I don't know whether you can see it. This is the deed of donation and trust. But we know that it was amended and so forth. When Parliament asked for it, they were given an incomplete copy by the current ministry, and you can see that this is quite a problematic, that a Parliament, which must exercise oversight, cannot get a full document about an entity over which they have this responsibility. But the reason, Blessing, is because the Mass Media Trust, the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, had complete control in terms of all the founding documents, starting with the deed of donation and trust, over its entities. And that is not only Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, but Ziana, Kingston, the community newspaper groups, and so forth. So it's the one that has the responsibility for appointing board members. They nominate the majority and they present them to an annual general meeting or an extraordinary general meeting, and the appointments are made there. Similarly, they appoint the management, and the management have a responsibility for appointing the editors and so forth. There is that editorial arrangement.
But that is transpiring right now. Is that not?
Of course, this is and I'm explaining to you. You asked why it appeared convenient for the ministry to operate all these years without the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust and therefore without the board. It's because it created an opportunity for the ministry to replace the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust and function in its place. And so the ministry, to appoint the board members. That in itself is problematic for a company that is listed at the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange and is supposed to be run in terms of the Companies Act. But the mini, and it's not a parastatal, and it's not a public enterprise. It's not a company owned by the state.
Would you say that it's illegal? What is prevailing at the
moment? You don't have to be a lawyer to see that. It is manifestly illegal. But you know, all the boards of Zim Papers from 2001 to even the current one that is headed by
Thomas
Tole, have been appointed by the ministers. They've tried, the current setup was a little bit strange. It was appointed on the 2nd of August last year. The ministry posted the names on their Twitter handle until somebody warned them that, you know, there are vultures around, and they deleted that. and then pretended that Zim Papers itself as a company had made the appointment. But Zim Papers itself does not make those appointments. The appointments but must be made by the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust Board. So it was about appointing board members, which is a Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust function, appointing the executives, the CEO and the financial director and the others. That's supposed to be done by the board of Zimbabwe, of the Zimbabwe newspapers appointed by the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, but critically appointing the editors, the ministry has been appointing editors since 2001.
So what's the role of the board? What is the role of the board anyhow?
A board that is not present has no role. You cannot ask what is the role of the board when the board was not there. In fact, the board is not there even as we speak. There are just a few people, so we don't know exactly what is going on. They're a bit silent about that. The dissolution, the purported dissolution of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust Board was in itself problematic because it was not carried out to its logical conclusion in terms of the provision for the its dissolution as provided in the deed of donation and trust, and in terms of the law.
Yeah, you are the one who was behind that. Would you take any responsibility in turning a public company into a state-controlled company as Zim Papers?
Well, I certainly take a full responsibility for causing the first dissolution step. And I also take, and then I have explained to you that I did it in order to stop Zim Papers from being privatized. Zim Papers was actually going to be owned by ZANU-PF Politburo members if we had not done that. So I'm happy that I stopped those Politburo members from taking over Zimbabwe newspapers. I'm very happy about that. But I regret that I did not conclude the process to cause the formation of the successor to the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust Board that we dissolved.
Are you at liberty to share with us the Politburo members who were eyeing the stake in Zim Papers?
There are those who had been ministers of information before me. I've exercised the liberty.
So what was behind the attempt to take it over? Was it to control information from a party political perspective or to asset strip?
From what I was able to gather and understand at the time, it was the last point, to asset strip. Yeah, and they were not working alone. They were working with their previous directors of information in the Ministry of Information, and they were working with some of the managers at Kingstones and Zim Papers, and they were working with some of the board members they had assigned to those entities, and there were one or two trustees of the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust who were also interested in that. An untold story about Zimbabwe regarding the situation in the year 2000 is that in 2000, the state or the government system had collapsed in 2000. And those who had been in government before us saw everything that culminated in the formation of the MDC, in the setting up of the Constitutional Commission, all those things. They saw those things as the end of an era.
So they wanted and to get out with the stake from government.
Yes, yes. That was happening across the board. This is why there was a huge list of companies to be privatized. And this list was drawn by people who never believed in privatization. Because remember, the whole SAP thrust was to privatize parastatals. And here was a government that was, in fact, resisting privatization. Nevertheless, having a long list, huge, that had been generated by ministers that were exiting. And their intention had been to privatize before the end of that government.
You became a sort of a powerful minister because you were sitting at the helm of controlling Zim Papers and also ZBC. Now, I want to understand from you.
I dispute that. That is, one of the things that fascinates me is how you guys sit there or wherever you are and you conclude without first putting the issue and then prove that what you are about to conclude from the issue is indeed the case. Because my own experience is that I did not become powerful because I controlled those things. In fact, there was a serious war. It was very difficult to deal with the ZBC and Zim Papers because they were deeply entrenched institutions with a lot of people, very powerful people. Remember, the most powerful person in information in Zimbabwe was Nathan Shamirira. And Nathan Shamirira was around in 2000. And not only was he around, he was the Secretary for Information in ZANU-PF. And he was very influential, make no mistake about that. In fact, when I was fired in February 2005, and I did not know who to talk to because I didn't have any political guru, I remember talking to the former Commissioner of Police, Commissioner General of Police, he became that, Augustine Chihuri. And he was asking me, so what are you going to do? And I'm like, I don't know what to do, but what do you think I should do? And then he was saying to me, because we're working fairly well with Chihuri. And then he said to me, Minister, I don't know what you can do. If I were you, the only thing I can think about is talk to Nathan Shamirira. That's how powerful Nathan Shamirira was. And he didn't want to talk to me. He was one of those who was actually firing me. He was one of those who was very happy that I have met my Waterloo and they were celebrating. So you guys, you have a tendency not to want to know what was actually going on, but to continue the conclusions that you have made from far away, to say, so you were very powerful. And because, no, I was not. You know, Blessing, the only thing I was, which I have now in terms of my experience and when I look back, because you guys are persistent in these views, you force me to look back and assess, which I think is a human thing. What I've come to understand, Blessing, is that in our politics, in Zimbabwe in particular, perhaps in other jurisdictions as well, if you can construct a sentence in English properly, whether in speech or writing, and you are able to forcefully make your case, and to also defend your case, and you are able to explain something, you will be blamed for what you are explaining. You will be perceived to be very powerful. You are controlling things when in fact all you are doing or all you are able to do is to explain things. Sometimes when I'm alone taking a shower, I regret that I've been able to explain things in my various roles, either as Shamirira's deputy or as the minister then, or subsequently when I came back as minister in 2013, or as the person who sat down alone, not with people, not with the soldiers and so forth, but alone with my computer, writing the ZANU-PF manifesto with documents that would have been given to me by either the ministers. You know, when you write or at least when I used to write the manifesto, I wrote the 2000 manifesto when I was not in government, and then I wrote the 2013 manifesto. So I just, I did the 2001 and the 2002, because there was the general election in 2000, then the presidential election in 2002, then in 2013. What would happen basically is that if it's understood and agreed, and the president says, help with this and you're right, the chief secretary of the cabinet and the president will write to permanent secretaries who report to him and ask them to give him assessments and reports on their ministries over the last 5 years. And then what they are planning for the next 5 years as ministries. And those things will go to the chief secretary. And then the chief secretary will give me. And when I'm writing, I can't be like imagining things. So I'm now informed by this. In fact, just right now, in saying what I've said, I've just advised the Vanamate Madanda and all those guys who don't know how, you know, who thought these things are coming. Because obviously they are writing silly manifestos right now. They don't know how this. But what I'm trying to tell you is I will be sitting alone. It's not, you know, like I'll be sitting with this and then telling this person and so forth. Now, being able to put information together, sitting alone with your computer at home, does not make you powerful. And being able to explain that manifesto the next day, it does not make you powerful. Whether you are powerful or not is an entirely different thing. Now, you want to claim that I was powerful at Zim Papers when the truth is, I failed to appoint people I wanted to appoint at Zim Papers throughout the entire stint of my first term from 2000 to 2005. There's not a single journalist I took to Zim Papers, not one. And I worked with the people I found there. And it was impossible.
So there were vested interests in making your job as information minister very difficult.
Yes, very difficult. And the people there, they know who would have taken them there. They would know that it's not you. And you then have to develop an ability of working with them, around them, but you know that their loyalty is not to you, because you didn't take them there. You know, people would say, oh, Caesar's wife, I did not appoint him. I don't know where the hell he came from and how, with that big body of his, he found his way at the Herald House. I don't know. It's me who found him there. You know, I only managed for the first time to appoint editors in 2013. But you know the fate of the editors I appointed. They were kicked out. And you know, I was called the devil incarnate by President Mugabe on the 5th of June 2014 at Nathan Shamere's funeral for having appointed those guys. So I think our society proceeds and the discourse is based on between no information and little information to draw conclusions. Because you have never given me the opportunity to actually say, okay, before I just say to this guy, okay, you were this, you were that. Let me ask him, what were you? What were you doing? How was it to be Minister of Information? And then either challenge some of it on the basis of some empirical data that you would have, because I do consider you know some things. I mean, you are the guys who run these things on a daily basis, and you have colleagues. You guys, there may be these distinctions But you people as journalists, I know firsthand that you don't have those distinctions. In fact, I know that some of you who work in the so-called private media get your lead stories from the public media. Sometimes they have a story that they've killed there, they give it to you. And it's proper, that is how the function is. However, I sometimes just get, if there's one person who was not part of the system, the political side of it, for all the years I worked in the government, it's me. You ask the journalist, you ask the managers of the parastatals that I oversaw. They will tell you that we would spend up to 12, 14 hours working on a regular basis. Now, bless him, you can't be spending 14, 12 hours actually doing professional work with the hands-on people and also be in politics. You cannot do that. Even if you ask these vice chancellors and lecturers, when I was in the Ministry of Higher Education, my last 2 years, we were spending, you know, sometimes we're finishing meetings at 6 a.m.
No, I do remember when you visited Kwekwe Polytechnic, where you had a meeting there, and I think it ended around 4 a.m. Because we wanted to have a meeting with you, and we failed to do that because you went late into the night. But Professor, I want to know the power that the Zim Papers has in delivering political control or winning elections in Zimbabwe.
I don't think that, from my experience, Zim Papers is pivotal in winning an election. It has no role, or if it has, it has not discovered that role. As you know, the reality is that you win elections in Zimbabwe through, or you get the majority vote through the rural vote. Let us say, if you are ZANU-PF. But I think even the MDC has discovered that for it to win an election, a presidential election, it must win some rural constituencies. There's no doubt about that. It's impossible to do that. Now, the rural constituency has nothing to do with Zim Papers. Absolutely nothing. Zero. That in itself must tell a story. Now, the role of Zim Papers is the propaganda war at the level of public perception in terms of the political class in the country and outside the country. And outside the country, it's through those embassies, international organizations, NGOs, and so forth. So the role that the Herald, well, I'm not the Herald as such because you're asking about the Zim Papers, that they play is they play a propaganda role in terms of creating perceptions in public discourse.
How important is that in power retention? Because I ask this because the effort that is there to ensure that the Zimbabwe mass media trust does not work independently. Editors, as you have said, is that they're being appointed by the ministry illegally so. Why all that effort?
Well, look, the control of the political class is very important. If you want to be a minister, you want Zim Papers to cover you. That is a small but telling example of the kind of role that an institution like Zim Papers can play. I mean, the president reads Zim Papers' products, discovers people, discovers issues, or learns about them from reading Zim Papers. And you know, in Zimbabwe, I am not sure now, I saw it changing quite rapidly in the last 10 or so years. But there was time when a significant part of the political class associated with ZANU-PF would not want to be found holding the Daily News or a copy of the Daily News or the Zimbabwe Independent and so forth. It was like treasonous to be found with that. So they'll be reading the Herald and they would know that this is what their political leadership is reading. And they would want to influence those stories to create narratives about what they are doing and so forth. So these are elite papers. The Zim papers products are for image making and they are very significant. Also, there was one time, you know, when I was in the ministry, when I joined earlier, or when I was appointed earlier, I was fascinated to learn that a lot of people who had no sympathy or anything to do with ZANU-PF, nevertheless, or even the Herald, nevertheless, bought it just for the classified ads. That this was a big thing going back to Rhodesian days. And so there were different constituencies. You know, I don't think the classified ads are a big deal in the era these days. And there's no, I think if what I hear is correct, I don't think there's any paper that is selling even 5,000 copies a day in Zimbabwe now, as we speak right now. The role is changing. The social media and the internet in general have changed this. So then these papers are no longer playing that role of shaping the mindset of the political class in Zimbabwe, defending the ruling class from internal and external narratives that challenge the ideology of the state. They've existed for that purpose. And that is why they have stock phrases, you know. The Herald, the Sunday Mail, finds it difficult to have editors who are dynamic, independent-minded, and who are analytical. If you are analytical, you will find it difficult to operate at the Herald and the Sunday Mail or Chronicle and Sunday News, because they have templates. And they've used the template for 40 years. That template, you know, one of the things that I hear some of your colleagues say, for example, they credit me with the use of the templates that we find at the Herald and the Sunday Mail. No, those templates, you know, people don't know how influential the founding ministers and permanent secretaries in the Ministry of Information, the Justin Nyokas, were in creating this template. I think it's beginning to crumble. But the fact that people like Joram Nyati, Edmund Kudzai, Mduduzi Matutu could not survive at these newspapers, it means the template is still very strong. You know, when we were in the Ministry of Information, as we were transforming the Zimbabwe Broadcasting Corporation, dismantled their news structure and created something called Newsnet, we came up with a template, because I suppose you can't avoid having some template you as a media guy, I'm sure you know this, but because we were tired of this single approach to news presentation on ZBC News, we said to them, it would be interesting if you surprised us, you know, we become creative and so forth. Mnyaradzi Wengwere would be a witness to this because he was the first head of Newsnet. We said, as far as we know, we can be wrong, but clearly every story must have three sides. You cannot just come and just tell a story, you know, and there's only one side to the story. Every story should have three sides. And we said, from a template point of view, there should be the thesis of the story, which is whatever the position the story is asserting, but there should also be an antithesis to that story, which is the at least some contending view, not necessarily the opposite, but different from what you're saying, the other side. And then you, as a news people with an obligation to your audience, you should synthesize these two views. So, you know, they then came up with, if you recall, something they would call the top story. So the top story had three perspectives. And they went on with this until Jokonya took over. And then when Jokonya took over, they were accusing us of, so what is this top story nonsense and so forth. There's just one line. And they went back to the one line thing.
But you were working with this a monster from the way you are talking to me, where you couldn't work professionally and there were vested interests. Why did you continue being there and now viewed as the hangman, the media hangman?
No, you know what? First of all, it's okay for people to have their views. But this notion of saying you get out is simply an untenable thing. It's an unreasonable, is the easiest thing to for people to say. I have not presented to you any story or account that says, you know, it was so bad, and then we achieved a lot, blessing. We achieved a lot. This idea that why did you hang there and not go is yours. It's not mine. That narrative you're saying right now is your own narrative, you know. I have not told a story, and I do not have a story to tell that says it was so bad that I wanted to get out. And then you ask me, if it was that bad as you're describing it, why did you not get out? No. Listen, when you work with professional civil servants or work with lecturers for 14, 12 hours a day, you cannot describe that as a bad thing and you want to get away or get out of it. No, that's not, no. And for me, I understand that change, reform will not be possible until those who are prepared to dirty their hands hang in there, get out sometimes, come back some other time, others come in, and so forth. That is how you build societies. I have absolutely no regret about my government service. No. I would not, that doesn't mean I'm happy with everything that we did. And it doesn't mean we did everything that needed to be done. You know, there are people who think that we were there about politics. I lived in Harare. For me, Harare was my residence and my workplace. But it was not my place of politics. I did not do politics in Harare. I did politics back home. In Harare, we did work. And as far as I'm concerned, the work that we did, the hours we put, whether at Zimpepers or ZBC were justified, satisfying, frustrating, of course, many things that we want. You know, sometimes people say to me, like when they look at what we did at ZBC, they would say, why did you close down Joy TV? And for them, they think we should just have allowed TV, Joy TV to continue the way it was doing. And if we had done that, would be some very nice guys. And that is the yardstick they want to use, some people. And yet, when we try and explain to them that, as a matter of fact, the story of Joy TV is a story of corruption by ZBC people, the guys who were running ZBC. They were now, instead of being broadcasters, turning themselves into licensing authorities, when in fact there was no law that allowed them to license the channel to anyone else. And they were privatizing a public asset. The channel is a public asset. And then they were restricting that channel for the people in Harare only. So you find Zimbabweans who think it was very good for them to enjoy watching another channel in addition to channel one, as long as they are Hararens. Well, one of the favorite phrases of mine in the early 2000s, Harare is not Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe. And Zimbabwe is not Harare. You can't want Joy TV for Zimbabwe, for Harare and have Joy in Harare when Bulawayo does not have Joy TV, when Vic Falls does not have Joy TV, when Mutare does not have Joy, you know. And if you are a public policy maker, you've got to try as much as possible to cater for the whole public. So, yes, I understand these guys from Harare being furious about Joy TV, but Joy TV was lining the pockets of individuals at Pockets Hill. Pockets Hills was literally about pockets, individual pockets,
but you for example. You then had a time where your then permanent secretary, George Charamba, was saying that you were trying to use the media, you know, Zimpepers, Tables, and ZBC to prop up your own image and those people in the G40 who supported you. How would you so plead?
I don't have to plead. I expect you to presume me innocent yourself without me pleading. I thought that's my constitutional right. But this is now much later, isn't it? These are the years, I suppose, as Chinamasa was claiming the other day, from 2015 to 2017. Or I don't know what this will be, because there was no G40. You know, when this issue of G40 came up, I was not in the Ministry of Information. Are you aware of that?
This was just your last
the G40 issue started mid 2015. Mm-hmm. Towards 2014 up to December, when ZANU PF had that Congress, Rugare Gumbo was calling us G4. He was not calling us G40. And the G4 was supposed to be Comrade Gasukwere, Comrade Joao, Opam Chinguri, and myself, up to December 2014. Then we went without a name for a few months in 2015 until Stanley Gama, who was editing Daily News, realized that, and we had used this G4 frequently, realized that he could not continue calling us G4, especially because Opam Chinguri had now become closely aligned with Mnangagwa, and we were having issues with Mnangagwa, and we were now three And he thought that they will lose a lot if they say G3. So when I was making noise about Generation 40, which I had started writing about in 2011, he thought he can conveniently baptize us and Christian us as Generation O, G40. You know. But then, Blessing, I was not in the Ministry of Information when that was happening, which is the point I'm trying to explain.
When you came back to the Ministry of Information and, as you said, appointed for the first time your own editors, this is when you are accused of trying to use the media as a power base. And your relocation to the Ministry of Higher and Tertiary Education was like to deal with your power base.
I suppose there is that narrative, but the truth is, it was less about me using it as my power base to project myself, but more that I was unwilling to project Mnangagwa, because Mnangagwa becomes vice president in December 2014, and the week of that Congress, which made him vice president, on a Sunday, I am interviewed by the Sunday Mail, and I say he has been appointed to assist the president and not anointed to become the president. And there's that interview. And Mnangagwa's people read that. They become very furious. Even Chiwenga was nervous. And he called me, read some Bible verse, and was trying to say to me, I must call Mnangagwa and assure him that I didn't mean this or mean that. There was a problem. And then we went for Christmas. When we came back, the problem was worse. And then in May of 2015, I do an interview with Heart Talk where I become more explicit that there's no way Mnangagwa is the successor by virtue of having been appointed vice president. A successor will be chosen in terms of the constitution of the party. Otherwise, he's there to assist the president. And they then got really angry with that. And they didn't know how to remove me from information. But there was quite a serious inquiry by MID after my interview with the Heart Talk. How did Heart Talk come into the country? Who invited them? And they were obviously trying to be clever about it. And that time, Charamba was getting involved. There is a famous account that I related to the Standard of my meeting with him, when he then confronts me and says, Minister, the commanders are very angry with you. They are upset with you. And then he relates all of these things. But that was just before we had, in June of 2015, those 22 by-elections in the country, which included Cholocho North. And then I contested. And Blessing, an untold story, but which is a very interesting story to show what these people did. And in my view, it demonstrates that it was less about me positioning myself and creating a power base, because I didn't need any power base myself. As far as I was concerned in my days in ZANU-PF, my power base was knowledge and technical ability. That was my power base. I did not need any other power base. I just needed to be able to function professionally myself, you know. But I understood that Mnangagwa and his people by that time in 2015 were in full swing with their succession agenda. And they had concluded that I was the wrong person to be in the ministry of information. And so when I won the by-election in Cholocho North, they took advantage of that to remove me from the Ministry of Information. And how they did it is that they used Prince Machaya, the Attorney General, to come up with a spurious opinion that he had not been requested to do, whose import was that by reason of having contested the by-election, winning the by-election, and taking an oath in parliament as a member of the National Assembly representing Cholocho North, I had resigned as cabinet minister because they argued I had been appointed on the basis of one of the five appointments that the president can make from outside parliament. And they said now it was going to be up to the president. If he wanted me back, he would have to reappoint me and I would have to take a new oath of office. But that effectively, I had resigned as from cabinet. And they didn't tell me this. So they wrote this. It was Prince Machaya conniving with Mnangagwa and Patrick Chinamasa. And then they gave the president that opinion. The president had been excited by my victory. He had congratulated me, was very happy. And then they surprised him with that opinion. But they were so indecent about it, they didn't tell me. So I then went, and since my taking the oath in parliament, I had attended two cabinet meetings. Then when I went for the third meeting, when the president walked in the usual way, he would greet everyone on his way to his seat. When he reached me, he acted like he was surprised to see me. And he said to me in Sindebele, "Ufuna nilapa?" And then I'm looking at him, "So kwenzenjan?" And while I'm trying to gather myself, he then repeats and looking agitated, "Ufuna nilapa? Puma, puma, hamba." And then he walks to his seat to sit there. And initially I thought maybe there was he was saying it in jest. And then I realized this is very serious. And I take my seat. And then he's looking at me and clearly not only agitated, but now showing a face of some anger. And then I realized that this is a problem. I go to him. And, you know, and I'm between him and the chief secretary. And he now realizes that I don't understand what's going on. And then he says to me, "We got an opinion from the attorney general that you are no longer a cabinet member." And then I feel like I should challenge to explain, to say, but president, and Mishek Spanda is listening to this. And then he's in the loop. But in his understanding, it's like, no, don't worry. You'll be reappointed and you'll be, you know. And he's whispering this to me on my left. But on my right is the president who is gesturing and is talking, you know, loudly. And these other people near there are hearing. And Mnangagwa is looking at us. And I see him, his face is animated, has come alive. And I realize that, no, this is a problem. So I say, "Thank you, sir." I go, I pick up my stuff and I leave. They got me out. But I just want to say, to show that it was not about me consolidating my base, but more about me being seen as the wrong person to project Mnangagwa in his quest for succession. Later down the line, Martin Dina, the then provincial minister or so-called governor for Mashonaland Central, had been appointed together with me as a not quite non-constituency, but outside parliament. He had been one of the five that had been appointed on those terms. He contested, I think the constituency was in Mazowe. Like me, he won. But unlike me, because he was working with Mnangagwa and the so-called Lacoste faction, they did not get Prince Machaya to write an opinion for the president that he has effectively resigned from his position. He just remained like that. And so you can see what was at play. Now, what I recall is that then the Zimbabwe newspapers in particular, less ZBC, but the Zimbabwe newspapers in particular, more so the Herald and the Sunday Mail, they were used against me. They demonized me. They're the ones who are now following my tweets and coming up with this concept of frenzy tweeting. They would always, when there would be a Politburo meeting, they would create noises and confusion to put on the agenda of the Politburo meeting, social media, abuse of social media. And the person that, in their view, was abusing social media is Jonathan Moyo. And it was all about Twitter and so forth. And Charamba was quite active then. But I was not in the ministry. And clearly, it was because also I had taken a clear position against Command Agriculture and its use or abuse, as I saw it, by Mnangagwa for his succession quest. So yes, Charamba became strident, but only after I had left the ministry.
As you speak, it appears that, because in your opening remarks, Professor, you said that the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust, which got money from the government of Nigeria, it did say that Zim papers should be used for the betterment of the development of media in Zimbabwe. Now, given all these fights that appear that it is serving political interests, would you say that the government of Nigeria is getting value for its money and what it was intended to do for the people of Zimbabwe?
Well, I would think that is not quite the correct way of framing the question, because I don't think it was the intention of the government of Nigeria to keep pulling strings on the people of Zimbabwe. If you donate, the donation is gone. And that's why there was a deed of donation and trust. I think the premise of the question is correct, insofar as you want to find out whether we can objectively say, in light of what has transpired, that the beneficiaries of the donation are getting the benefit that they deserve, because the Nigerians are out of the picture. They made the donation. The donation triggered the constitution of a person, a legal person, the Zimbabwe Mass Media Trust. And that legal person is founded by the deed of donation. And in that deed, it says these are the beneficiaries and they should benefit this way. And it is therefore appropriate to ask, as you are doing, whether, given what we've seen and some of what I have shared with you, we can objectively say that the people of Zimbabwe are benefiting. And the answer is a resounding no. No. And you know what? As far as I'm concerned, blessing, you will find people who will say, well, the beneficiaries are not benefiting because of this minister of information, that minister of information, that politician. And I feel that is what is wrong with the Zimbabwean. They don't take responsibility for what is theirs and agitate over it to ensure that they get what is theirs. In any other properly functioning society, media advocacy groups would have long known and understood that this deed of donation seeks to benefit all the people of Zimbabwe in their generality and diversity. And whenever that is not happening, they would agitate until it happens. They would not sit there and be content by pointing fingers that, you know, we would have benefited if that minister had done this. We would have benefited if that minister had not done this. That's not how properly functioning democracies do. You know, I don't understand why we don't have in Zimbabwe, or we have not had, several, not just one, several civic organizations dedicated to ensuring that the Zimbabwe mass media trust exists and discharges the functions as its founding document. I don't understand why that is not the case. And in these other cases, whether you're looking at countries like Sweden or the UK or even the United States, India, South Africa, even next door, you have organizations that keep democracy alive. You don't have people who think that you keep democracy alive by occasionally pointing fingers. That guy, an individual, didn't do this. How about you? Democracy is only possible when its architects, namely the people, continuously insist on public officials fulfilling their public obligations. It's not only true in the case of this issue that you're asking, Leslie, it's also true even with the right to vote. Zimbabweans would rather say, why is that politician not making sure that I enjoy my right to vote, that my right to vote is protected? I voted for A and I'm being given B. That's not right. Well, if it's so fundamentally important as that, then it behooves you to do something about it. That's why there was that distinction between society and the state. Society needs to act. And I think this is why there is a problem, Blessing, to be very honest with you.
Yeah. But you take an oath of office to protect and serve the people of Zimbabwe and also to observe the Constitution. Why do you, as politicians, continuously want civil society to push you? Why not just deliver to the people like
no,
to the minister?
I mean, look. And I think this is where you get it wrong. You might as well find a robot that you program to just act like you want, and then it will deliver. But if you are dealing with human beings, there is a reason why society is interactive. Is it important for public officials who take a public oath to abide by the Constitution to do so? Yes. But do you think that public officials actually sit to read the Constitution? They don't. I don't know of any public official who says, let me see what my constitutional obligation is, and then they grab the Constitution and they're going through the Constitution looking. There's no politician anywhere in the world, not even in America, who does that. Politics, by its very nature, is interactive. What is wrong in Zimbabwe is that public space is not characterized by the kind of interaction that is necessary in a functioning democracy. Look, Mnangagwa, who keeps lying to the world that Zimbabweans are enjoying more freedoms since he came into office, that they are abiding by the constitution, is actually systematically taking away the rights of the citizens from the constitution. And this constitution, they made it only in 2013, blessing. And one of the rights that the constitution, that the public adopted through a referendum in 2013 gave, is that the public should participate in the appointment of judges, including the judge president, the chief justice, the deputy chief justice, and so forth. But because Mnangagwa wants to control these people and their offices in the same way they used to be controlled before the new constitution, he removes that right from the public participation. And it does so 3 years after its adoption. And it was adopted because the old process of the president appointing alone was not properly or sufficiently helpful or meaningful to citizen participation and so forth. He returns to it, therefore. And you and the citizens do nothing about it. Someone is snatching a right, and all you want to say is, but you took an oath of office to abide by the constitution, so you must just abide by the constitution. No, make some noise. Make him fail to breathe. Put your neck, I mean, your leg on his neck. And then he will not do it.
But would you be saying this if you were still in government, Professor?
No. I would not say it here in the manner I would say it. If I was still in government, I would not be in the dungeon here where I am right now. So I would not be speaking here from the dungeon, and I would not be saying this. Because when you are in government, you speak through government structures. And when we were in cabinet, we used to have ruthless debates with Mnangagwa and his cohort. Ruthless. We did not agree. But when you are in that situation, you don't come out and go to Mount Kilimanjaro and start shouting that yesterday I was saying this and so forth. That's not how it works. So this question, whether an outsider speaks like an insider or an insider speaks like an outsider, is a no-brainer. And I don't understand why Zimbabweans bother themselves about this question, you know, because it's a non-issue. It is completely a dead point to say to me, now you are speaking like this, but when you're in government, we're not speaking like this. Yes, I was not speaking like this because I was in government and there are channels. We used to have fierce. Look, do you really want to know what I said when I presented that Blue Ocean documentary? It was ruthless, nothing like what I've said in public. Do you know what it means to sit in Politburo and call Obed Mpofu to say to him, well, you have the body of an elephant and the brain of a rat, and you're speaking inside, and then someone leaks it outside and so forth? I don't know why any one of you thinks it's rational for someone who is inside to speak inside, fight, and then go outside and say, I've come to tell you that I said that guy is a baboon when we're in cabinet. You know, let me tell you, for example, one of the things that I've seen coming up from time to time persistently is that over the bond note debate, is the when now we attack, me and others, who my colleagues who are no longer in cabinet, when we attack the bond note, people say to us, no, but you are the one who said this, you supported, you have. Well, you know what, blessing, just take the bond note as an example. The bond note, when it was introduced by Chinamasa, in cabinet. Cabinet rejected it. And Chinamasa came alone. You know, he was the finance minister at the time. He came there, you know, and he thought he would razzle and dazzle us with the funny stuff. And cabinet said no. Then he thought he would steal the thunder from the governor because he then just came alone. Then he realized that, you know, he had an uphill task. So he connived again, find a way 2-3 weeks later, sneaks the item back. But this time, he comes with the governor of the Reserve Bank. They present the same story, and cabinet again says no. So we think it's over now. We have rejected it twice. So what happened? So Mnangagwa, who was vice president, responsible for economic ministries, then they connive with Chinamasa and the governor of the Reserve Bank, the three, and then they decide there is some critical information about this issue which can't be discussed in cabinet. That has not come up, and if it were to come up in cabinet, it would cause security problems, and what, therefore, what they should do is themselves alone behind the back of cabinet, which has rejected the bond note. They must go and talk to the president and make the president realize that there are these consequences, whatever they are. And they then get the president to agree. And then it comes back no longer for discussion in cabinet, but for information. Yes, we are aware, you said no because of that and that. But anyway, there are some important things that have come up and we've discussed with His Excellency and blah, blah, blah. And maybe, that's what I can say, His Excellency. And then it's over to the president. And then the president says, yes, it was this and this. And so they came to me and blah, blah, blah. And well, for now, let us let them go. And then we'll see what it happens and so forth. It's difficult. Okay. So next item. Now, do you think that when that kind of thing happens, what should we do? Or what should those who are affected by it? They should actually come out and say, you know what, guys, we rejected this thing on two separate occasions, and we've made a decision as cabinet. And if you want to be technical about it, you can go to the constitution and find that cabinet has that responsibility to advise and to decide. But if you have that kind of scenario that I've just shared with you, what do you want us to do to come? So some of us, what we decided to do was to try and find, because cabinet discussions, remember, they are confidential. So we decided we will congratulate Manguja and Chinamasa, especially Manguja, and call them geniuses for coming up with this idea so that they take responsibility for it. To say whoever came up with this idea is a super genius. He did this, right? Congratulations. Wow, wow. If we were in a sophisticated society like we see, we all watch TV, CNN and so forth, and you see how spirited, but also fair-minded and rational political debate is in America, the journalists and the academics, people would be taking Chinamasa and Manguja and Mnangagwa to task for what they did. And they would know eventually that actually they went behind the cabinet in order to get that bond thing passed. But that cabinet did not support that. So when you ask me, it's easy for you, General Moyo, to speak like this because you're not in cabinet or government. But we know that if you were in government, you would not be speaking like this. I think that is a fundamental. You are simplifying an issue, an issue that you, especially as news people, would also help the society understand, because an insider cannot speak like an outsider. and an outsider cannot speak like an insider. That is a reality which rational people should understand. It should not give rise to anything. It can't mean that, you know, there's therefore something wrong. Those guys, like as we speak right now, it's a fact that this cabinet has no consensus on the way forward. And it's a fact that they are ignorant of the decisions because most of the decisions are being made outside cabinet. But no one is going to come up and say that.
Patrick Chinamasa also accused you. In fact, just a week ago, if you listened to his press conference, he accused you of hanging on the helms of the skirt of the former first lady, usurping executive authority, stripping cabinet decisions, and bringing your own with the help of the former first lady, Grace Mugabe.
Yes, in fact, I am actually doing a Twitter thread that is dealing with these issues. I'm responding to him. I'm taking my sweet time to respond to him. But, you know, because now you have raised the issue, so I have to deal with it in the context of your question. You know what, a blessing? I have to first express quite some frustration. Here is another example where I feel the media in Zimbabwe does society a great disservice. Because you cannot have somebody like Chinamasa, who is in the top six of ZANU-PF, making such a scurrilous allegation, and you don't ask him to back up. Because all you can tell me right now, Blessing, is that Chinamasa simply said the so-called G40 members of cabinet were attacking the constitution. He actually said they had a determined and sustained onslaught against the national constitution, never mind the ZANU-PF constitution, national constitution, by reporting to the former first lady in Mazowe. That's what he said. And they did this in order to do two things, he said. One, to reverse cabinet decisions. Two, to usurp the executive power of the president. Now, Blessing, in any society that has a proper media, you will say to him, give us two or one example. You can't let a person just make such a blanket statement like that. He does not say that they reversed this policy or that policy. He does not say they usurped this power or that power. For you, the Zimbabwean media, it's enough for him just to make that allegation. So are you guys telling me that if someone came to you, Blessing, and said, you're having an affair with your your neighbor's wife, we should write stories that Blessing is having an affair with the wife of his neighbor because somebody just said that. Have we become so low as a society that that is the standard, that it is sufficient to make an allegation? It's not necessary to support the allegation. And instead of making an allegation, you say, on such a day, Jonathan Moyo, Sevia Kasukwere, Patrick Joao, Walter Mzembe, and whoever else was seen as a G40 minister, reversed this policy. This policy, we had made it as a cabinet, but it was reversed by this. And the way they reversed it is that they went to the former first lady to do this, and would want to know how did then the former first lady reverse it. Did she use her husband? And did the husband then come? Because there's no way the first lady would come to cabinet and say, I've reversed this, or write a letter and say, listen, guys, I've reversed that. So we would presume that then the first lady must have said to the husband, you know, darling, go and tell those guys that this is out. And then he comes and says, you know what? That decision we made last week, no longer. You know what? The fact of the matter is, Patrick is a mad black Rhodesian. He's crazy. I now understand he's the only one. It must be something heavy for ZANU-PF to bear that in its top six, it is a black Rhodesian in the top six who never left the country when all his age mates left the country. But he was so silly as to remain at the School of Law in Rhodesia and stay. No, he's a typical Zaku-Zaku. And when he was making those attacks on us, he was speaking like a Mgagao graduate. You would think he's a war vet who trained, you know, in Maputo, is talking tough when the guy just, all his life he has spent, if you want to find a pure breed, a pure black Rhodesian with a Pekinini mentality, it's Chinamasa. How does a guy who is that old, who was this Zimbabwe's attorney general for that long, who was the Minister of Justice for that long, speak like that, disrespect people's rights like that, blatantly lie like that? Now, I just told you, Blessing, Chinamasa, Mnangagwa, and Manguja reversed a cabinet decision on the bond note. Chinamasa as a finance minister and Mnangagwa as VP and justice minister usurped the president's power regarding the appointment of the former and late Chief Justice Chijia Usiku, and they fired him by forcing him to take an early retirement, and the package for his retirement was worked out by Chinamasa and Mufumira, Prisca, Lacoste, and Mnangagwa. So Mfumira and Patrick, they work out the package and they put all sorts of sweeteners, not approved by the president, to sign off on his chief justice. Mnangagwa is a justice minister, causes Chijia Usiku to take an early retirement, causes him to go home, and puts Luke Malaba to start acting, his choice. The Zimbabwe Independent published a story on this. And this is a fact, unlike Chinamasa, who is so reckless that he can make a stupid falsehood with a straight face, which he can't back up. I'm giving you an example of a usurpation of an executive power. They usurped the power of the president. And the people who were involved, and I named them Mnangagwa, Chinamasa, Prisca Mfumira, and Prince Machaya. And what happens then, Blessing? And Mishekspand then writes the letters to Chief, the then now late former Chief Justice. Then he takes the money, he agrees, he goes away, and he starts farming. Then there's a funeral of a hero, and people go to the National Heroes Acre. And he goes now as a former Chief Justice. He meets the president and they're greeting each other. And then the president learns that he's now former Chief Justice. He says, what? How? How did this happen? Now, who had the executive powers? President Mugabe. And now he doesn't know about this Chief Justice. So you know, this thing.
How does that happen? How does that happen? And, you know, you are keeping a man in power.
Well, you should not ask me. You know what you should do? Mm. No, you should not ask me how that happened. Because I have just described to you.
Eh? But how does that happen that a president doesn't know where his chief justice is? I mean, and his executive authority is grabbed.
No, it's not that a president does not know where his chief justice is. It's that his chief justice has been illegally and unconstitutionally been removed from office by his vice president, his finance minister, his public service minister, and his attorney general, and his chief secretary. These people have connived to exercise the president's power to get rid of a chief justice without the president knowing. Now, blessing, give the president then credit for having then found out, and he then corrected it and brought him back. He was brought back. But you know, what I'm telling you is, you are the one who started this blessing. And perhaps it's making you uncomfortable, my friend, but you are the one who started this. You said to me, Patrick Chinamasa accused the G40 of usurping presidential powers and reversing cabinet decisions. I'm telling you. And you know, one of the reasons why I've taken my time not to respond to Chinamasa is I've been going through cabinet minutes. I challenge Chinamasa to name one case or instance where the so-called G40 reversed a decision or usurped an executive power. Already in this short discussion, I've given you concrete examples. Also, if you want, Amendment 1 of the Constitution, they usurped the presidential powers. Mnangagwa put a false affidavit saying that the president had authorized him to support Zirani when he had not. And we took Mnangagwa on in cabinet, and we have minutes. And I'm telling Chinamasa through you, if he continues this nonsense of his, we will be forced to do something that really, really we would rather not do. Really, which is to publish cabinet minutes. As someone who served in cabinet on two separate occasions, it will be a heavy decision on my part to publish cabinet minutes. I respect their confidentiality. But if Chinamasa, who is a lawyer, a former prosecutor general, attorney general, who was a prosecutor, and a finance minister, and a member of ZANU-PF's top six, who suddenly has discovered that he can speak like the Mgagao people, and is holding meetings every Monday to say absolute rubbish, falsehoods. If he continues blessing, I'm saying through you, we will publish cabinet minutes. These guys, you know, Chinamasa does not know that this nonsense which he said on Monday about Grace Mugabe has been discredited. There are many people in government, including the army, who have abandoned the nonsense that they intervened because Grace Mugabe had usurped executive powers. It's rubbish. And the way we know them as we do, if Grace Mugabe had done that at the time as it was happening, he alleged it was from 2015 to 2017, they would have published it. And blessing, we've had our fights, a journalist and a politician in the normal way, but you are one of our respected journalists in the country, and you are one of the most well-informed journalists. I give that to you. You would have known about it as it was happening, blessing. You would have known about it. You would have heard people in Kwekwe talking about it, and it would have been published. It was used to justify the coup. It was used to convince SADC leaders that, no, we need to intervene. The president is now suffering from diminished capacity. His wife is exercising his powers. We need to do something. That's what they said. Well, we congratulate them that their lie was believed at the time. But there's nobody who believes that now. The only fool who is still so foolish as to say it now, 3 years later, when everybody else now knows the truth, is Chinamasa. No one else is saying that rubbish. If Chinamasa wants to be in cabinet, let him be a little bit more intelligent. Maybe he is the one who is now suffering from diminished capacity. But he clearly is unhappy at that shake-shake building. He misses being a minister. We heard that from Mliswa.
But he says at least
he's saying these radical things.
He says he's happy. In fact, he has more power because he's supervising government from Shek Shek building.
Yeah, but if you believe that, you would believe anything. If you believe that he's supervising, you can even see how haggard he is. You know, the way he looks, you know, you can tell that the guy is suffering. You know, members of PAC are closer to the supervision of things than him. You know, do you think that Chinamasa is more influential than Kudata Gwire? You, do you really think so? For example, I sympathize with him. I can understand his difficulty, you know. But my advice to him, he does not have to be ridiculous. He just remained in Rhodesia. He will not make up for the time he squandered in Rhodesia instead of going to Mgagao by speaking like he just came from Mgagao yesterday. It won't help his case.
We have run out of time, but it was a very interesting discussion. We ended up straying out of the topic of discussion that we were facing. But I will give you an opportunity, Professor Jonathan Moyo, to, in your closing remarks, to reflect on the issue of the media and its role in developing Zimbabwe. And with what you know from the inside, will it ever play that role if there's no radical change?
Well, I think that the kind of role which the state media has played over the years is an endangered species. I think it's no longer up to the state or the government or even those in charge of the sector as to whether they will transform or not. We are now living in an era where the transformation is not going to come from inside the state in Zimbabwe, but it's already happening around the state. I think, for example, an overwhelming, if at least perhaps, if not that, an increasing majority of Zimbabweans are no longer relying on ZBC or Zim papers, and I dare say AMH either. More and more people, the reason you are here, there now, blessing, is because you have found it unavoidable to have a footprint or a digital footprint. In the old days, you were happy with your paper circulating out there and your vendors pushing it and your marketing guys getting subscriptions and so forth. But now you yourself, this platform of yours is increasingly becoming a major platform, not just for Zimbabweans who want information, but for policymakers as well. But it doesn't have the strictures of state regulation. And even if they try, they will never succeed. It's beyond them. And more people, the other day, I was reading that Kukurigo, WhatsApp platform that was set up a year or so ago by Edmund Kudzai, has 370,000 subscribers. And then 2 weeks later, I read some PR statement coming from Zim Papers that they are now setting up a WhatsApp platform also. It was unavoidable not to draw some conclusion and connect the two. So I'm, like others, optimistic that the transformation of the media has already taken place. We read, even now, people saying things that we used to say when we could get away with them, to say the social media is irrelevant, the people are not following that, and so forth. But when I hear Nick Mangwana and Monica and others saying that today, I cringe because it's not true. The majority of people are getting their information through WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, and all these other platforms that are going. And there is the revolution has come. It is now for the state media to catch up. And as they catch up, they have no choice but to change. If they write nonsense, we are now able to respond to it in real time. We don't care. We used to go down our knees begging them to give us the right of reply. We don't care anymore, you know. And so it's unfortunate that we are going to, that the state in Zimbabwe is going to be forced by technological development to change. And the change will have to affect the structures of ownership. The truth that we have not faced in Zimbabwe in our independence period thus far is that it is wrong for the state to own the media. I gave you the example of Voice of America, that the Americans will not allow Voice of America to broadcast this because it's state propaganda. And by definition, it is propaganda because the state cannot control or run any media and have it as anything else but propaganda. It is propaganda. It is unavoidable. The only thing that the state must concentrate on is giving information about what it is doing in terms of its program. If it has a vaccination program, it should give information about who has been vaccinated and where. It should not give information of a propaganda nature, editorials and all that. It should give factual information, and that information should go through parliament. One of the endangered species of the state is the Ministry of Information. By definition, a government ministry of that nature is a propaganda outfit and can't be anything else. And a democratic society does not need a Ministry of Information. One measure or standard or yardstick of determining whether a country is democratic and a democratic Ministry of Information. Wondering whether it has a Ministry of Information or not. Anywhere where you find a Ministry of Information, you know there is a democratic deficit. It's not necessary to have a Ministry of Information unless you have a propaganda agenda. And especially now with the transformation that is happening around us. So I am optimistic that definitely coming, and that it will be of an institutional nature, and you are going to see the state exiting from running newspapers, radio stations, and television stations, and getting more focused on policy delivery, and its information will be on that. This other realm of public information will be in the hands of citizen journalists and people like yourselves who are finding a better and much more efficient and effective media platforms. So I and you know, in the past, Zimbabweans thought that the transformation would come from constitutional change. But we know that the new constitution is very progressive regarding the issue of the right to information, access to information, freedom of expression, but it changes nothing. If you are in a society where you can come up with a society, I mean, with a constitution like that, and then within 3 years, it's overthrown by the army, then you know that you need more than just legal changes. It's a question of political culture, but more fundamentally, in terms of this sector, it's a question of technological transformation. And I'm satisfied that the technological transformation that is taking place will force the state in Zimbabwe to back off. I'm not hearing. Norma.
Can you hear me now, Professor?
Sorry?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now I can hear you, yes. Yes.
Yes, I want to thank you very much for joining us and spending 2 hours with us and explaining to us the issues that are of interest to the people of Zimbabwe and for the development of our nation. Our motto here at Heart and Soul TV and Radio is that we allow the nation to talk to each other, not through each other. And we are privileged to have hosted you this evening and given us insights to issues of national and public interest. We want to thank you so much from the team behind the scenes at Heart and Soul TV and Radio and myself to be able to have had the honor and the privilege to host you this evening. An acclaimed professor, a person that many in Zimbabwe love and some also love to hate. But thank you so much for joining us on the situation right now. And like I said before we started the program, your cap, please keep one signature cap for myself so that when we do meet, I hope we do meet in the future, you could give me one signed cap, your trademark cap. But thank you very much, viewers, for joining us. This was Professor Jonathan Moyo on the situation right now. And today we were zeroing in and narrowing in on the media, on public media and its power in terms of development. I hope to host you again soon where we can talk politics, the political structure of our nation, where it is going